into, I talked about California's corporate agribusiness, pesticide activism, and environmental racism. I'm going to start from where I started research many years ago, and that was the West Central Mexico countryside, and introduce you to where farm workers come from and what they have faced in the wake of NAFTA. So this is a farm family in a little village called Los Sauces de Perez. It's in the high mountains of Jalisco, just outside of Cuquillo, Jalisco. And this family and all the ones I met survived for between, I think, 7,000 and 9,000 years on the corn, bean, and squash intercrop. This is an agroecosystem that's been widely studied by scientists. And what they found is the reason why no pesticides were needed, the corn yields are higher, etc., is because of the symbiotic mutualistic relationships that all the plants have with one another. So the corn acts as a support for the beans. The beans actually have roots with a direct connection to the corn plant, so they're pumping nitrates in throughout the season. And then the squash plants have very broad leaves and they shed the ground, and that retards the weeds. And all the farmers that I interviewed in Mexico told me they never had a problem with pests or with production yields or anything. Until some of the hybrid seeds sent from the United States and the pesticides and the machinery came into the Mexican countryside. Now, this type of intercropping system was common throughout rural Mexico, as I mentioned, from 7,000 to 9,000 years that we know of. And what happened is that as farmers saved seeds from one year to the next, their seeds became better and better adapted to the unique environment that they were in. So what we have, ultimately, after all of this time, is strains of corn that are adapted to so many different environments. I mean, Mexico has deserts, high mountains, they've got jungles, you can find corn adapted to anything. And Mexico was declared the repository of corn genetics for the entire world at one point. And corn, as you probably know, support is one of three grains that support all of humanity, rice, wheat, and corn. So preserving the genetics is in the best interest of everybody, because what would happen is if anybody had problems with their corn anywhere in the world, they would cross their corn with a strain of Mexican corn from a similar environment, and that usually solved the problem. We did that in our country in the 70s with the southern corn blight. And by finding a strain in Mexico resistant to the corn blight, they could start a whole new strain of corn plants for the south that was resistant to this blight. So very important to maintain the genetics. This is Juanita Tejada is her name. She's a farmer. And she farms about 4.5 hectares of land with her family as help. And the reason why the farming families are so large is because they need the labor. However, they use very few resources. So I think that you have to weigh both population and resource use, whereas we have smaller families, but we're very resource intensive using. This is a definition that I really like of sustainable agroecosystem, which the corn, bean, and squash intercrop represents. One that maintains the resource base upon which it depends, relies on a minimum of artificial inputs from outside the farm system, manages pests and diseases through internal regulating mechanisms, and is able to recover from the disturbances caused by cultivation and harvest. And this is a definition from Steve Gleisman, who's written widely about agroecology. But now we have NAFTA. NAFTA started in 1994. It was signed into law by Clinton, and basically Mexico got rid of its protections at the border for these small producer farmers. So prior to that, if you were a U.S. Farmer with lots of corn subsidized by the government, and you came to the Mexican border with a truckload of corn and wanted to sell it in Mexico, somebody at the border would charge you a high enough tariff that it wouldn't be worth your while to take the corn into Mexico. And that protected all of these strains of corn that are so vital to humanity, essentially. The goal of NAFTA, free trade, was to get rid of the tariffs at the border. And there was supposed to be a 2 or 3 year period of time in which farmers, these local small producer farmers, could find alternative employment. But in fact, all the tariffs were dropped at the border within about 18 months. So what happened is massive, literally tons of GMO corn started being dumped into the Mexican countryside. And Mexican farmers lost their livelihood because the cheap corn from this country, most of it GMO, undercut the price that these farmers had been getting from the local government. And so what happened then is that the farmers could not support their families anymore. It would be like you or I going to work on Monday and our boss saying, you can still work here full time, but we're only going to pay you half your salary. That's it's an equivalent of that. So could you still pay rent? Could you buy food? All these things. And most of the farmers felt you couldn't. So they were given three choices, really. There's not, and by the way, this is a total violation of the International Agreement on Human Rights. You cannot steal other people's occupations. And this was done massively by NAFTA in the countryside. So in order to survive, some farmers, and I did meet them, they're so attached to their land, it's been in their family so many years that they decided they'd rather starve in Mexico than to leave their land. Very sad, but that's how they felt. Other farmers left their farms and went to big cities and looked for work. And Mexico City today, if you go up in an airplane, is rimmed with shanty towns of these displaced small producer and subsistence farmers. And then a whole nother group decided to make an undocumented border crossing to the United States. Whereas before NAFTA, we had approximately 4 million undocumented people in the U.S. Today, if you listen to Trump and his cadre of people, if you think, oh, I won't say anything. Anyway, you listen to him and you find out that we now have 11 million. And most of those are from economic refugees of NAFTA who were forced off their land and forced to come here. Now, since all they know how to do really is to grow crops, many of them went into U.S. agriculture. And our state has a huge number of these undocumented workers. The figure I've heard is 75%. In Santa Cruz County, where I'm from, we have about 83% of the 21,000 farm workers are undocumented. They live in constant fear of deportation, and Trump's scare tactics certainly don't help at this time. So that's where we're at today. This is California's corporate agribusiness. As you can see, it's very different from the agro-ecosystems. This is industrial corporate agribusiness where huge, vast areas of land are planted in a single monoculture crop. And the only way you can maintain a crop like this and prevent degradation from insects on a massive scale is with the use of pesticides. So pesticides are plentifully used, and we have these huge agrochemical companies producing heinous pesticides that not only damage the food and remain on the food, unless you get organic, and I'm told even that has some, but also harms the surrounding communities as well. And of course, these same chemicals have gone into Mexico. This is a farmer with a backpack applicator spraying who knows what, but all of our GMO corn was, or a lot of it was sold to Mexico at one point before a federal judge prohibited the sale of GMO corn in Mexico in 2013. Half of Mexico's corn was from the United States and GMO. Now, with those farmers who are the guardians of this genetic diversity, with them gone from the farm, then these strains of corn are lost forever. I work with an agronomist in Cuquillo, Jalisco, and he is trying to establish a seed bank to save some of these seeds. But we've lost a huge amount, and this is concerning to me because this is very perilous in terms of homogenizing the genetics of the country. And if there's ever an outbreak of something that can attack that particular genetic combination, they'll lose everything. We could have famine. So of course we don't think in terms of the future, it's only in terms of short-term profits. Many of these farmers that spray like this in Mexico have bare skin. Some of them buy these liter containers of pesticides from the United States. Including things, horrible things like paraquat, and they pour it into their backpack applicator and then fill it up with water. And then if they can't find a stick to stir it, they stick their arm in and stir it. And I tried to explain some of these are absorbed through the skin, and then when they do, they collapse. You hear stories all the time of farm workers collapsing because they stirred with their hand or their applicator leaked while they were spraying, and collapsing in the fields. They could be miles away from the nearest town and they die. It's really tragic. Okay, so these are farm workers in Watsonville, California, and I should mention something about our state. We're a growth industry. We produce about $50 billion worth of agricultural products, just the state, every year. About 350 commodities, a third of the nation's vegetables, and two-thirds of the nation's fruits and nuts. And Watsonville is ground zero for California's $3.1 billion a year strawberry industry. And our state produces 88% of the strawberries grown in the U.S., and strawberries that were picked this morning will be in Japan tomorrow. So they're sent all over the world. I mean, this is big business. Salinas is the nation's and the world's salad bowl for greens, and production of many, many types of leafy greens. However, there is a transition away from leafy greens toward strawberries because it's such a lucrative crop, and we'll talk more about that. Farm workers in the Pajaro Valley are, many of them work as many as 10 hours a day, 6 days a week, and their salary is so meager that it doesn't even pay the rent. So in one case, in Watsonville, I work with a family or families, and there are 17 people living in less than 1,000 square feet with one bathroom. So they live in grinding poverty. I mean, it's just phenomenal to me that we have this major blight in our society and nobody's aware of it. And of course, NAFTA has been a real boon for the growers because they're not going to organize and form unions like Cesar Chavez did, since they're undocumented and they live under the constant threat of being fired if they say anything or being blacklisted so no one else will hire them. So it's to me, it's really a form of slavery of the worst kind. And this is just another picture of corporate agribusiness. Now, one of the things that gets farm workers out of bed in the morning and in the field, bent over all day and doing this arduous work, is the belief that their children will have a better future. And they live, that dream keeps them alive and keeps them kicking, and even when they're in agonizing pain from muscles, sore backs, and everything else, they keep that image in mind. This is one of the pesticides that's used ubiquitously. I'll get to that, but right now I'm going to mention that the EPA estimates that there are between 10,000 and 20,000 cases of physician-diagnosed pesticide poisonings each year, and that's just the ones that are reported. I know that I've talked to farm workers, and they describe symptoms that I know that they've been exposed to pesticides. And the fumigants make up about 20% of agricultural pesticide use in California. And this year, 47 farm workers were poisoned by the pesticide chlorpyrifos in Bakersfield. And I just now found out from Lucia Calderon here, who is an organizer for Californians for Pesticide Reform, thank goodness, that we've had 24 poisonings in Santa Cruz and Monterey County, right? So, and that's just been since May. So they live with this constant threat. They have an average life expectancy of 49 years, which is just, to me, amazing. Now, this is a summary that was put out by the Department of Public Health and summarized by Californians for Pesticide Reform. And basically what they did was they studied 226 schools in the Pajaro Valley and in the Watsonville area and in Monterey. And they found that between 329,000 pounds of highly hazardous pesticides were applied within 1/4 mile of these 226 schools in 2010. And that consisted of 144 different highly hazardous pesticides. So these fumigants in particular, and some of the ones that vaporize, actually after they're sprayed, move through the fields right into the classrooms, and the children then, and the teachers, of course, become affected. And I should mention, over 500,000 students attend these schools. And more studies are coming out demonstrating the impact of pesticides on children's physical and mental health. For instance, the UC Davis study is one of the most important and damaging. It indicates that there was a 7- to 8-fold increase in the rate of autism in children born in California between 1990 and 2000. Wouldn't you think people would want to know something about why that was happening? I mean, it's just... the Department of Public Health has found there's a definite association between pesticide exposure and certain insecticides and autism. Now, glyphosate, this is the Office of Environmental Health Hazard Assessment has listed this as a carcinogen this year. And the only problem, glyphosate is Roundup. How many of you have heard of Roundup? Has anyone not heard of Roundup?
It's also called Poncho.
Poncho
is another name for it when it's being sold.
So, in any case, they don't have to start labeling Roundup containers as carcinogenic until July 7th, 2018. With that, since most of the public has been hearing since 1974 that Roundup is as safe as salt, many, many people are going to be exposed to the effects of Roundup. And it's the world's most heavily used conventional pesticide, 280 million pounds in the U.S. annually. It's sprayed on more acreage than any other pesticide. It's genotoxic, carcinogenic. There's a direct correlation between exposure to Roundup or glyphosate and non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. And so it greatly increases the chance of non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. And I think, personally, I think it's unconscionable for them to sell a product to the public without any warning whatsoever that can kill the people. Don't you think that's outrageous? So I would like to invite you to my guerrilla action here that I take regularly. And that is, what I do is I go into places like Ace Hardware, wherever they sell Roundup, and when no one's looking, I get labels and I put them on all the containers, and they say, warning, contain cancer.
Do you have a file that can be shared that we can print those?
Well, I can get. I'm passing them out. Anybody who wants one, you can make your own.
Okay.
So I'll just pass them around. Is that good? Okay. Yeah. Here.
Someone should announce that on the main stage. That's awesome.
Yeah. Well, I
limit it to this room, please.
No, well, I do the plenaries up at UC Santa Cruz, so I announce it to the entire freshman class. I pass them out there too, and those students love it.
You don't indoctrinate them in something else?
What?
You don't indoctrinate them into some other world?
Oh. Well, I just think we have to take, if the EPA and all these other organizations that we pay tax dollars to are not going to deal with this, how many people will get non-Hodgkin's lymphoma because they're not aware? I just think it's unconscionable. I can't live with it, so that's why I do this. So I'm glad if you join me. I'm forever grateful because more Roundup will be labeled, and who knows how many lives will be saved. Okay. Then we go to chlorpyrifos, and that I have a vendetta against chlorpyrifos big time here. Chlorpyrifos is an insecticide. It was banned in 2000 for residential use because some scientists found that when rats and other small animals were exposed, it damaged their brains and spinal cords. However, so what we did, what I noticed happened after 2000, is we sent containers full of this to Michoacan and throughout the Mexican countryside, and it's sold under the name of Lord's Bun and Lure's Bun, and this is a place you can just walk into a Michoacan, come down to Sequoia, and buy your liter container of chlorpyrifos. Now, it has not been banned from agricultural use, however. Residential, yes, but agricultural, no. So it's probably one of the most widely used pesticides or insecticides, and it is drift prone, so it's sprayed and it moves through the field into the classrooms, ultimately damaging the brains of the children. Now, the worst part of this for me is that the Chamaco scientists at UC Berkeley did a 17-year study of mothers and children in the Salinas Valley. And what they found and published recently in this publication is that there is a direct correlation between the amount of chlorpyrifos or organophosphates in general, of which chlorpyrifos is one, a direct correlation between the amount a pregnant woman is exposed to and the loss of IQ in her child once it reaches age 7. So the way it works is this. For every 522 pounds of organophosphate pesticide a pregnant woman is exposed to within 1 kilometer, the child, once it reaches age 7, will have lost 2.2 points of IQ. And some of these women have been exposed to at least 3 times that much. So now their children, when they're age 7, have lost IQ points. And it's very interesting to me that we hear about this in Flint, Michigan. We also hear about, you know, the Standing Rock Sioux clear across the country. And about 91% of the people in the Salinas Valley are Latino, and I have never seen an article in the newspaper about this form of environmental racism. I think it's disgraceful. And so then these children, who are now 7 years old, intellectually deficient, go into the surrounding schools, chlorpyrifos is sprayed, it goes into the classroom and damages their brain and spinal cord more. Now, one of the things, as I mentioned, that gets parents out of bed in the morning and into the fields is the hopes for their children's future. Well, what's going to happen with these kids that are already so damaged before they even go to school? I just think it's absolutely reprehensible. I get so angry. So I think this needs to be handled. And we have a letter that's written by Lucia here that if you'd like to join this form of activism, we're sending letters during a public comment period to the Department of Pesticide Regulations, which doesn't do that, by the way. And so if you can write some comments and sign, we will send these off for you, because I think this needs to stop. Now, the Californians for Pesticide Reform, who we're partnered with in this project, want a one-mile buffer zone around the schools, and they had hoped for a week's notification of spraying so that parents can make decisions about what to do with their kids. And I've been to public comment periods, we've done press conferences. In fact, chlorpyrifos was scheduled to be banned everywhere on March 31st. And guess what? Scott Pruitt met with Dow executives and reversed the ban. So it's perfectly okay to gas Latino children, and so their brains don't work. And one of the things in recent days that it adds to all of this is the fact that some of these farm workers who have children that are intact enough to go to school become DACA recipients, hoping for their child's future. And so what do? We threaten DACA. It's just, I mean, again, anywhere they turn, the door slams shut. It's phenomenal to me what is done to keep this slave force in its place. I mean, what can a person with brain damage do other than work in the fields? It's a great way to maintain the next generation of farm workers. It's very cruel. Chlorpicrin. Yeah, this is another one that's used. It was called vomit gas in World War II because it makes people vomit. It's a potent carcinogen. It has these effects, developmental and reproductive toxins, and used to reduce populations of soil nematodes. And then we've got Talon, which is also carcinogenic, and it's a fumigant pesticide, possible endocrine disruptor, possible developmental toxin. And then we have the UCLA study. I have, I guess, only one copy left of this, but what they found is that if people are exposed to multiple pesticides simultaneously, the effect is aggravated or potentiated. So it's much worse than if you're sprayed one and then followed by the other. You get a triple dose instead of a double dose, essentially. So this, in turn, creates more problems. You probably just Google UCLA plus synergistic pesticide study and find the information.
Dr. Lopez, I can mention it was the Sustainable Technology and Policy Program at UCLA. I'm not sure who the authors were, but that might help. STTP.
And sometimes it's multiple people, like the Chamacos scientists group. So the Department of Public Health study showed that Latino children are 91% more likely than white students to be exposed to the highest levels of hazardous pesticides. Why don't we hear about this in the newspaper? I mean, it should be at least as important as Flint, Michigan, since we're here in California, right? The cancer rates in Watsonville are children are very high. In fact, one nurse who worked, I guess, in public schools, she says that she knows a nurse at Stanford that says that one half of all the children in the oncology unit there are from the Salinas Valley. I mean, can you imagine how heartbreaking that would be for parents to have their kids get cancer and end up in that? Yeah. And then it's very interesting to me, about 2 years ago, the crab season was called off in northern Santa Cruz County because of the presence of a neurotoxin, domoic acid, and yet Latino children are exposed to, in South County, to all these neurotoxins and pesticides, and no one calls anything off. It's, the contrast, isn't that interesting? I mean, it gets worse. It's just so frustrating. And so, number one, I just feel like, I'm sure all of you do too, we need a complete transformation of the agricultural system. We can no longer continue with this ridiculous industrial agricultural model. And there are at least three studies that I've read, one from the UN and one from the Rodale Institute, 30 years, that show that if we converted all the world's agriculture to organic overnight, tomorrow, we could feed the entire human population and mitigate climate change by 30 to 40%. I mean, this is just stupid not to do that. Just stupid, you know? Yeah.
Well, I might be parsing this out a little too much, but I think the Rodale study was about regenerative agriculture, which is not the same as organic. Well, regenerative is a sod-based agriculture.
Right.
Organic is not a...
But it doesn't use pesticides, and it does use diverse cropping systems, right?
Yes.
Well,
yes.
Whatever you want to call those.
Well, I just want to make sure that we're clear that, you know, the Rodale study, which I'm just very familiar with, that's all. Was mostly based on like soy and corn crops, so not like vegetable crops.
Yeah.
Which is still a huge difference. But anyway,
The UN study, though, I mean, there's been several that have come out with the same conclusion.
Yeah.
And so I think it speaks to the power of these agrochemical industries. And speaking of their power, I got some data that's very interesting on Dow. Dow AgroSciences manufactures the most chlorpyrifos marketed as Durspan and Fluorspan. And in 1995, Dow was fined $732,000 for not sending the EPA reports it had received on 249 Durspan poisoning incidents. There were, in 1998, Dow tested Durspan on 68 recruits at a lab in Lincoln, Nebraska. And they also fed Durspan to inmates at Clinton Correctional Institute in New York to assess the impact of this chemical. It sounds like Nazi Germany, doesn't it? And then in June 2000, as a result of pressure from environmental and public health organizations, including the EPA, Dow withdrew registration of chlorpyrifos for use in homes and other indoor places with children, but not in the fields. And I mentioned about the study with the children from UC Davis. In 2003, Dow agreed to pay $2 million, the largest penalty ever in a pesticide case in the state of New York, in response to a lawsuit filed by the Attorney General to end Dow's illegal advertising of Durspan as safe. And then in December 2016, President-elect Trump picked Dow Chemical CEO Andrew Lavaris to head the American Manufacturing Council. I mean, it's just, it's absurd. I've got a whole list of these things.
Excuse me, but my understanding was that Clark Carefus has mostly been phased out. That it's really, I just studied the wine industry, and I know almost none is used there. What crops is it still being used around?
Strawberries.
Yeah, strawberries is always
the big one. Strawberries. So it's certainly not phased out in the Salinas area.
Can you speak, mentioning strawberries, to me, I'm ignorant of this, about Driscoll's in particular? Driscoll's, because you talked about Driscoll's, the berries produced. I would just like to get to just a quick and easy one. It's like, is absolute no? Is that the...
You know, there has been a boycott. There was.
Right.
An entire West Coast boycott of Driscoll Industries because of the way they treated farm workers. And I read a report that, and it went from, where was it? Sakuma
Berry Farm, Brothers Farm.
Washington, down to Baja, California. And in Baja, they actually send the military to beat the farm workers.
Yep.
So I will never buy Driscoll again. I was horrified. So that, you know, that's, again, these big corporate organizations basically functioning with impunity.
It ties into Whole Foods and all that stuff.
Yeah, well, I went to my local New Leaf Market and took them the data. And then within a week it was gone. All of Driscoll was gone. And they even hung a red summary of all the data right in front of where the new berries are sold to inform the public. So at least in some places they have a conscience.
And what's the other berry brand that's organic and unionized?
Swanson Berry Farm. Yeah, buy Swanson Berry berries. They are good. Jim Cochran's a good guy. I mean, he even has a UFW contract for all his workers. It's one of the only, in fact, Swanson Berry and Fire Ranch are the only two that I know that are certified by the Agricultural Justice Commission. So, yeah. Okay, so this shows you the difference between industrial agriculture and small-scale farmers who cool the planet and feed the world. We don't need industrial agriculture, period. And so here's what to do. Become informed, read up on pesticides used in industrial agriculture. I think everybody really needs to learn about these things and start taking a stand because they're terrible. Pressure the DPR, Department of Pesticide Regulation, and the California EPA to do their job and restrict these substances. And again, we've got this comment letter here, which you can fill out. And if you can fill it out and sign it, I'll send it in personally for you. Farm workers need four things for their work to be recognized as valuable: comprehensive immigration reform, a living wage, and a contract with the grower so the grower doesn't steal their wages, which is rampant. So if we can get those four things, I may be able to stop ranting. This kind introduced a bill into the Senate, federal Senate, to give farm workers who've been in the fields 2 years a blue card so they're not deported. Isn't that fabulous?
Yes,
so support her bill as well.
Thank you so much.